Hello and welcome to Topham Chats. Welcome to 2016! Woo! And welcome to my guest, McDom. Hey man, how's it going?
That was a very enthusiastic intro, Top. Yeah, I'm doing good, man. I'm doing good. How's things?
Yeah, things are good. I'm excited to get back to recording again because I recorded the last two like at the same time, like over 2 weeks ago now. So I'm just like, okay, I finally gonna put stuff together and talk about new stuff that's happened. We're going to talk about Star Wars, we're going to talk about Fallout 4, and I will say at the top of this that there are going to be spoilers, because, well, it's going to happen, because I want to talk about things. But yeah, I had a pretty awesome holiday time, and I did lots of stuff. I got a nice new guitar that I think I've shared pictures of, and yeah, there's a few other cool things that have gone on. I just got more baking stuff for Christmas, which was
baking
awesome.
Stuff is always nice. Like, yeah, it's one of those things. Yeah. I'm moving around so much at the moment. My job, like, I'm moving every 6 months. Mm-hmm. I have to like live out of a closet, so I can't buy like all the nice baking stuff. And, I don't have a blender. I don't even have a fucking microwave. It's really annoying.
Actually, I don't have a microwave, but I haven't had any instances where I've needed a microwave in I don't know, nearly 2 years now. So it's just like one of those things.
You get used to it, yeah. Yeah. But it's nice when you go. Like, I went home for. Obviously, you went home for Christmas or New Year. Yeah. They have a microwave, and I'm like, what is this sorcery? What is this thing which will instantly cook my food?
Oh my god, I don't even have a kettle, which was
that's quite bad.
Bit of a pain when Rachel was here. She's like, I want a cup of tea for breakfast. I'm just like, but no, I don't have it. Just use a saucepan. Great. So that had to happen. But yeah, I've been having a good time with my gifts. Like I said, I got that. I got Catan as well, and I haven't had a chance to play that yet, so that's a board game. Are you familiar at all with Catan?
No, I've got no idea what you're on about.
So Catan is possibly the most important board game that exists. It like won loads of game design awards, and it really brought around the revolution of tabletop games. Like, over the last 20 years, Catan was the first game that really had the progenitor
of, say, like, you know, Dungeons & Dragons and stuff like that.
Dungeons & Dragons is a different kind of case. Like, board games in particular, like, yeah.
Not tabletop board games. Because I know there's a difference.
Well, no, it is tabletop board games, whereas D&D is more just a role-playing game. It has its own systems. It's just, it's like... I don't know. It's kind of different. But Catan kind of like revolutionized like short hour and a half, 2 hour games that are very simple to pick up but hard to master, and it's designed so well. It's very interesting to play. So I just got that and I'm just like, this is the most amazing. And I haven't had a chance to play it yet. So
I was about to say, you need people to play it with now. That's the problem with board games, you can't play them on your own.
I know, but yeah, I've got a group of people I can play with, so I'm just like, yeah, this is pretty cool. What did you do for New Year's?
New Year's was kind of special for me this year, actually, because a friend of mine just bought a house, actually.
Oh, nice.
So we basically had they moved in just before Christmas, and they kind of half moved in, half didn't, because they were getting a load of stuff for Christmas. It's him and his missus.
Yeah.
So they had a house and they had like pots and pans. Didn't have any knives to cut any food with because they got a full set of global knives off their parents for £500.
Nice.
Which are really nice knives, incidentally. But when you've been living in a house for a week without knives, it gets kind of difficult.
Yeah, I can imagine.
But no, New Year's was good. It was really weird actually because my friend never went to uni. Like this guy, he just went straight into a job and, you know, he's working for this business, he's working his way up. So he never had to do, like, social functions, if that makes sense. He never did, like, house parties or anything like that.
Yeah.
So it's the first, like, major house party he's done, and it showed because he forgot to remind people. Mm-hmm. So he said people, like, 2-3 weeks ago or a month before, like, oh, I'm doing something for New Year's, you coming? Everyone's like, yeah, it's fine. Didn't chase anybody up about it. The morning of, rang round saying, everyone coming? It's like, well, no, because you haven't made any plans. So he bought... like enough alcohol for like 20 people, and there was only 6 of us there.
Awesome. So,
yeah, it was a really good night though, regardless. Yeah.
Ah, cool. I went over to my friends that I play D&D with. I went over to their house, And we just played board games. We played... actually, we didn't play a single board game. All the games we played were card-based. As soon as I said it, I was like, wait, no, that's not right. We played Legendary, which is the Marvel trade... deck-building game, where you get to build up against heroes. And we got absolutely thrashed by the game conditions. Just completely annihilated. We couldn't build up strong enough, fast enough, and we just got overrun way too quickly, which was a bit of a pain. But, yeah, that's what happens in Legendary. You either have scenarios where you're not doing so well, and then it flips, or it just absolutely annihilates you for, like, ages.
See, I'm fine because we played a bit of Cards Against Humanity, which is always a good laugh when you got a group of people who've known each other for, going on 20 years now, a lot of us.
Yep.
And then you've got... we also ended up playing Texas Hold'em poker, which I could play all right. Like I play it quite often. Mm-hmm. My friends not so much. So they're complete idiots when betting. And we decided because we were inebriated and it was 4 a.m. that we play with actual money. So I came out with 20 quid. So
nice.
Yeah, good night. Free alcohol night. A free bed to sleep in and 20 quid.
Awesome. Yeah, we also played these other games. We played Munchkin Loot Letter, which is based on Love Letter, which is just a simple card game with, I can't remember how many cards. I'm trying to do maths in my head, but I can't be bothered. So you have like a set number of cards. There's a certain number of each card, and you can count the cards to try and figure out the combinations and what card's left and who has what card. And there's all rules like written on the cards that you need to follow. And they're very, very interesting. It's like a very interesting way to play. So far, I'm unbeaten. I haven't gone flawless through a game, but, like, you play it in rounds. So, like, overall, I haven't been beaten in the games we've played, but in each round, I've lost a few. But that's okay. But it's a lot of fun because it's all about deception and just, like, yes, and playing the cards at the right time as well, which is very, very interesting. We also played a game called Starflux, which is just a game that the goal's constantly changing, and you have cards that you put down in front of you. The rules are constantly changing as well, and it's really difficult to explain unless you're to play it, which is one of my favourite things about it. And then we played Adventure Time Munchkin, because Munchkin's amazing, and Adventure Time is also awesome. And I also won at that, because I'm devious and terrible.
We should try playing that sometimes with the Good Guy Gamers. That'll give everybody a run for their money.
I know.
The amount of times we stab each other in the back, it's
so good.
We're playing... Over the Christmas period last year, we actually took a break in Let's Plays. This year, we just played Gmod for 2 weeks, basically.
Oh, nice.
And one of the members, Distracted Gamer, she recorded one of the nights, or part of one of the night.
Yeah.
Where we played Trouble in Terrorist Town and Murder. Uh-huh. So, you know, deception all round. She then tweeted me the other day. She was like, so McDom seems to hum menacingly, aside from insanely laughing like an evil genius. He hums menacingly when he's the murderer. Like, I don't even realise I'm doing it. But yeah, I suppose I was going around like hunting people going, hmm, 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 hmm.
She's picked up on your tells though, so now she's going to be like, run away from Dom!
She's incredibly deceptive and perceptive as well.
Yeah.
It's kind of scary like how quickly she picks up on things. There's a few people who are starting to pick up on it quite quickly now. But yeah, it's insane.
Ah, cool. So yeah, how have things been with the Good Go Gamers? It's been a while since I've caught up with most of the people, mainly because the people I talk to in the Good Go Gamers at a regular basis are the ones we play D&D with, and we haven't really played that for a while.
So yeah, so the sum total of that is me, Beep and Gal, and then... I suppose you talk to Izzy every now and again, but she's been absent from the GGG for a while now, because
mainly because she moved house, and she's got really no internet. If you've seen the picture of her, like, internet stats.
Yeah, it's horrible.
She's got, like, 480
Jesus Christ,
down
yeah.
and 80 up or something. So like, that's kilobytes, not megabytes. Oh, that is, like, the worst internet
I've
seen
in a
long
that's,
time.
Yeah, like, my home internet about 5 years ago.
Yeah.
Like, it's horrible. But anyway, mm-hmm. It's been going good. We've been doing, we've kind of got it on a cycle now where we do, start of every month, we do... browser games, so like Cards Against Humanity. We haven't played Town of Salem in a while. We need
you
to go back and
play
that.
Haven't played RuneScape yet. Gosh.
No, we haven't. the problem with that is because a lot of the other members, well, the more influential members like Kel, Woods, I think Beep at some point. They played RuneScape way back when, and they're very bored of it.
Yeah, like, same here. I'm so bored of it. Like, I would join in, and I'd be like, yeah, but my character's so buggered at the moment because I need membership to do anything on that character because there's, like, no spaces available for anything in my bank. It's like, it's not worth it ever.
You're speaking gibberish right now. I have no idea.
I know. Okay.
But anyway, it's like, for example, Woods, he's trying to do his YouTube stuff, and now he's on FIFA, but way, 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 way back when he started doing, like, you know, 2009 or whatever, 2008, he was doing RuneScape videos like, here's how you farm for treasure, here's how you get this item, here's how you do this.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, guides and stuff. And then that all got flagged because he was playing, like, Breaking Benjamin over it, so, yeah.
Yes.
Copyright!
Yeah.
No, so we do browser games, and then general rotation is Team Fortress 2, Gary's Mod, obviously we do Minecraft every Saturday. We had a really good one this week as well for Minecraft, because there wasn't a lot of people around. Beep and Kel weren't there, I was the only admin on the server. So me, Distracted Gamer, Chemix, Orange, Indy, and Sparky decided to play some survival.
Nice.
And so we just got into that, and we haven't played survival in a long time.
Mm-hmm.
So it was just nice to do.
Cool. I've been playing a lot of survival recently. Like, Rachie and I have been playing Minecraft, like, non-stop. We might have put, like, I don't know, somewhere between 20 and 50 hours in over the Christmas break into Minecraft. Yes, we play it too much. And I managed to mine, like, well, we over a few sessions, we've mined way over like 100 diamond ore. We've got fortune pickaxes, so we've got like 300 diamonds out of it, and it's just silly. And then we've just stockpiled so many resources. We found the end portal as well, and we're just farming level 30 enchantments, and it's just like, oh yeah, we're just wasting all our time just preparing to go to the end. Now we've both got infinity bows as well, we're just like, yes, this is going to win. There is no way we can fail. We're playing on easy as well, so it's not particularly...
I play on easy. You've won as soon as you got an infinity bow and iron armor in that case. Then again, if you plan on taking on the Wither later, then you might need a bit better equipment.
I already have 3 Wither Skulls as well.
Yeah, so you could do that before you do the dragon, because that's just literally, was it, Endert and... Soul Sand and the Skulls, I see.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But no,
We found a portal, so we're going to head there at some point to the end of the dragon.
One of the many Let's Plays we haven't done yet, I don't know why we haven't done this, is we still haven't killed the Ender Dragon in the Good Guy Games server. It's still alive. After a year and a bit of playing that game. We know where the end portal is, because I accidentally... we do the King Let's Plays. I think the King at the moment is... It's King Androgynous.
Uh-huh.
No, I can't say his name properly. I always call him Androgynous. It's not his proper name. But anyway... Andrew is the king now, after anime. Before that was Beat, before that was me. And when I made the Let's Play, I accidentally burrowed a bit too deep in the wrong part of the map. Came straight into the room with the end portal, and I was like, oh, shit. But the point I did that, I'd already built like my throne room, and I'd done like seven or eight other challenges, so I'm not relocating any of this stuff.
Yeah.
So now we know exactly where the portal is. So it's just like, well...
Nice.
It's just a case of farming a few bits of diamond, getting enchantments, and getting the eyes.
Yeah.
But we just haven't got around to doing it.
Yeah. Yeah, I have, like, I don't know, I got 75 blaze rods on one trip to the Nether. And it's because I had a looting sword, so I was like, ha ha ha, ha 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 ha. So I get all the loot ever. And then I already I don't know how many... enderpearls I've got. I think I've got over 160 enderpearls right now. It's kind of silly.
Jesus.
Yeah, I hoard a few things very...
So yeah, you can go right in. You're not even trying to farm for like netherize or anything.
No.
No,
I'm totally prepared and ready.
I do remember way back when, I say way back when, it's probably about 2-3 years ago, I made like farming traps and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So I had this system, I had like a blaze spawner, which was trapped within this massive redstone contraption. And basically I just had to stand in one point and then like a series of redstone like repeaters and switches and whatever, and it would trap all the blazes into one place.
Mm-hmm.
And then crush them all and then just give me the blaze rods. And I just like left my thing idling, and I'd come back with like literally my entire inventory full of stacks of 64 blaze rods.
Nice.
After about 20 minutes, half an hour.
Mm-hmm.
It's just like, insane.
Yeah, we got really lucky that we've got a zombie spawner within like 100 blocks of our house. And then there's...
So yeah, you're just looting them, basically, so is
like,
what you're doing.
And it's like, just go 27 to 30, drop down three levels for a level 3 enchantment, then... And then you're done. It's like, yes. And then we need to repair things. It's like, oh, that does take all our levels. But it does not take long to get all the levels. But it's okay. But yeah, Minecraft's been a lot of fun. So, I've also been playing, in my free time, lots of Fallout 4.
Lucky you. I've been away from my PC the entire Christmas break, so I haven't been able to play a lot. I did descend back into Dark Souls, unfortunately, because I have Dark Souls 1 and 2 on PC, and I have them on PS3, and the PS3 is at my parents' house, and I have no desire to bring it over because it's kind of dying right now. So I've been playing a lot of Dark Souls 2. I was going through with my friend, though, because he's the guy who moved into a house. He plays a lot of Fallout, so we were playing on his Xbox One. But the PC version runs so much smoother.
Fair enough. The PS4 the PS4 version runs fine for me.
It runs smooth, but it's just the load times.
The load times take forever. Yeah,
They're about a third of what they were on the Xbox on my PC, just because of the power I actually have on that thing. Mm-hmm. Which has just got an upgrade, so, you know, that's nice.
Nice. Yeah, I decided, I was like, well, I accidentally ran into... Okay, so we're going spoilers now. I accidentally ran into Nick Valentine. Like, I was just like, oh, I'm going through this. I'm just exploring the world. And, like, he's part of, like, the main quest line. Like, I just happened to run into him at entire... Like, I was just like, oh, this is a vault. Hack, hack, hack. Oh, and by the way, last time you were on, you were like, oh, I play a melee character, so I run up and punch things, right? Mm-hmm. I totally found a machete, and I'm just like, okay, I'll give this a try. And now I cannot play with a gun. I'm just like, I will hit everything
it's,
and punch.
It's so
punch,
much fun. You just drug up on medics and psycho... And just run straight in. Buff out. And yeah, it's better when you have... It's even better when you have power armor.
Yeah, like, that's what I've got. I've got just, I've got this machete called Krem's Tooth. That you find... Oh, that's so much fun.
That's the one you find in the mine, isn't it?
Dunwich.
That's creepy.
Yeah.
Reminds me of a place called... In Fallout 3 called Dunwich Borders. Where there was just a thing full of ghouls. Yeah, same fucking vibe.
I was talking to Rachel while I was playing that bit, and I was like, Rachel, I'm so freaked out. Help, help, help. Ah!
I found a creepier place than that, though. There's two places which I think are a bit sort of creepier than that. I think we talked last time about the place, the School of Witchcraft, or whatever it's called.
Oh, yeah, you go in there and there's a death
There's the death claw, yeah. We talked about that last time.
I was not prepared for that.
Museum of Witchcraft, that's what it was. That doesn't say. And then there's also, I don't know, I can't remember where this is, but because I came across this quite early on. It's somewhere in the main city.
Uh-huh.
They've made Saw, basically. There's a basement.
Yes, I found it yesterday. It's by a hospital. Mm-hmm. It's just a car park, and you just go in and...
Yeah, yeah, it's not even like an actual internal area. Yeah, it's just like this...
No.
And there's like the monkeys and then there's the ghouls everywhere and there's traps everywhere. And it's so creepy.
I found it yesterday. I was just freaking out. I was like, what is happening here? And I figured out like there's a puzzle to open the doors. And I was like, this is easy. You push one, then three, then two, and all the doors are open immediately. I was like, that's not really a puzzle, but.
Yeah, it's 1, 2, 3, 1, I think it is. Or 1, 2, 3, 2 or something.
Oh, I just pushed 1, then 3, then 2, and it was opened all.
Oh, is it? Okay. I did it a long way then.
Really simple. I was like, oh, I can get this. Looked at it, I was like, oh yeah, that makes so much sense. Did it and then like walked through, but yeah, there's like so many traps. I had to like pull my companion over to me like 3 times because there was like so much to just like disassemble. And disarm.
Yeah, there's so many like traps and like trip mines
and things like that.
Who do you have as your companion then? Because I don't do the companion. I have the Lone Wanderer perk at rank 3, so I've got I've got like 50 plus damage resistance and 25% extra damage because I don't have anybody else with me.
Ah, okay. Yeah, no, I started off with Dogmeat. Then I had Piper. Then I had Kate from Combat Zone.
Oh, she's cool.
She's awesome. She's so funny.
There's
a quest to her to take her to a vault as well. I've done that. And that's when you get like enough affinity with her.
So which vault is that?
It's called 95? Vault 95, I think.
Is that the one where it's... Because I've done all the vaults aside from one now. Is that the one which is full of raiders? Or is that...
There were...
Or the synths and raiders. Sorry, not raiders. I mean gunners. Was it gunners or full of drugs? Yeah?
Well, it's gunners, but it was originally a drug rehab.
Yeah. Vault. Yeah, that's the one.
Yeah.
I just cleared that place out just now. So, damn it.
Yeah, so I took her, like, she, after a certain amount of time or, like, a certain amount of actions you do when she's around, she'll be like, I want to go to this vault, I need some help. And, yeah, that was really rewarding. I was like, this is amazing. And, like, it's just those small things, like, oh, your companions actually want to do things and they will guide you in the right direction. And, like,
yeah, I think about half the companions have a companion quest, and once you complete said quest, you get a perk. I know every companion gives you a perk. I know Katie's got a quest, obviously. I know that Dance has got a quest, but I'm not sure.
Mm-hmm.
I know Piper's got a quest. I know that Valentine's got a quest.
Yes.
And there's a guy...
I've got Valentine travelling with me now, actually.
Yeah, I can't remember the name of the guy, but there's... in Good Neighbour.
I haven't got there yet. It's marked on my map, but I haven't actually been in.
So, okay, there's... Do you remember... How much did you play of Fallout 3?
Lots.
Right.
Lots and lots.
What was the name of that place which was just full of kids? What's it called?
Big Town.
That's the one. No, that's the place the adults went, but... Yeah, the place where they sent you off to Big Town.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
But anyway, yeah, you know what I'm on about, right? So...
Yeah. It was in a cave.
Yeah.
I know exactly what
you're talking
about.
You had to go through it for the main quest.
Yeah, you go to Big Town. Yeah.
Yeah, there was a kid there called
Little
McCready.
Little Trouble in Big Town. That was the quest for it.
Yeah. Jesus Christ, I don't even remember that.
My brain works.
Anyway,
weird,
there's
so.
the mayor of that town was a little kid called McCready. He used to wear like a combat helmet.
Uh-huh.
Or one helmet. He's in Fallout 4. A bit grown up because it's a bit afterwards, and he's a mercenary and he's a good neighbour. So you can hire him. And he's got a nice quest.
Oh,
supposedly.
Nice.
I haven't done any of the companion stuff yet though. I'm doing my second playthrough now. And
okay.
I said to myself, right, I'm gonna go melee, because I did unarmed last time, right? So I'm using a baseball bat.
Uh-huh.
It's like, okay, I'll go melee this time. I'll use a super sledge eventually.
Uh-huh.
And I'll do use a companion.
Yeah.
Still have not used a companion because they still piss me off.
Oh dear.
Like, they were thick as bricks in Fallout 3, and then Fallout 4 just takes the cake.
I don't think it's
worse.
Too bad for me. Like, sometimes I get stuck, I'm just like, I just need to get out this door, but, yeah.
See, I was used to Fallout 3, the only companion I had was Forks, and he was just insanity. Absolutely insanity on legs. Like, he would ruin everything, and then he used to just kind of, like, teleport around. It's just like, yeah, okay, get out of my way, and he just disappear and reappear, like, behind you. It's sweet.
Okay. Nice. Yeah, I was, I found this like, archive thing, and, there was a baseball bat in there. It was like the 2076 World Series winning baseball bat. And it has a chance to send your opponents flying, like, off into the distance. I'm like, this is the most amazing baseball bat I've ever found. It's like, I can't wait to use it and just see someone just whoop, ping.
See, I'm having a lot of fun with a railway rifle at the moment.
Not found one yet. And I want it so bad.
I've only found one.
Yeah.
And it was in the hands of Desdemona, who's the head of the railroad.
Yep.
So I did, like, for the story, I did... How far are you through the story, by the way? Because I know we said spoilers at the top of the podcast, but I don't want to spoil something for you.
Okay, so I've discovered the railroad. I have just found that Sean is potentially with the Institute. So I think I've done, like, the fourth story mission only.
Yeah, you are not very far into that story-wise.
I am not very
okay.
far into it story-wise, but I am level 30-something.
Well, eventually... Jesus Christ, I'm only level 50. I finished the story like a level 40. Anyway, eventually
well,
you have to choose...
Being like,
yeah.
Oh, I should do the story.
Eventually you have to choose at some point, like, which faction you stick with.
Oh, I've already discovered the Brotherhood and the Railroad. And so I guess there's a, like, a permanent choice.
There's four. There's four factions.
Uh-huh. What are the other two?
There's Brotherhood, Railroad.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I'm only going to tell you the ones you've discovered so far. There's Brotherhood, Railroad, and Minutemen. You can go with the Minutemen for the entire thing.
Oh, I'm with the Minutemen now. And then, is the Institute a possible other one?
Yeah, the Institute's the fourth one.
Yeah.
So, eventually you have
to choose.
That's like
choosing Kaisar's Legion in Fallout New Vegas.
Yeah, I chose Brotherhood because
yeah.
I love power armor.
Yep.
And I'm a sap for people with miniguns. I chose Brotherhood, and part of the Brotherhood quest line is you have to go and kill the Institute. Basically, you have to go wipe them off the face of the earth.
Yep.
So, yeah, I had to go in and just kill everybody, even though I'd done the most, like, you know, the stupid side quests you have to do?
Uh-huh.
Like, I finished all of the Institute ones. I'm talking... No, not the Institute ones. The
Railroad
ones. Yeah. Like, I'm talking the guy who gives you the stupid little things to put up on places. I can't even remember what it's called now.
Yeah.
Crazy Dave, whatever the hell his name is. Yeah, ran out of them. Like, all the things, like, ended quest lines, because they do eventually stop.
Yes.
And then I just went with the Brotherhood anyway and killed them all. So, but yeah, no, Desdemona has a railway rifle, or she had one with me.
Oh, okay. So. It's likely, seeing as she's part of the railroad.
Makes sense, yeah.
Yeah.
If you stuck with the railroad,
yep.
Then you probably get given it as part of their storyline.
Yes.
But obviously, if you go Brotherhood, and especially if you go Institute, I know for a fact you have to go kill them. Don't know about Minutemen. I don't know about their storyline whatsoever. So.
No, I'm kind of bored of the Minutemen, because they're like, go capture this for us. I'm just like, okay, fine.
Yeah, it's go there, kill stuff, suddenly you have another settlement to take care of. It's like, oh god,
I've got too many settlements. It's just like, oh, they're being attacked. I'm just like, who cares? I've got enough people right now anyway. Woo!
I've got four settlements in my main campaign, which is the two you start with, like the whatever it's called, and
Sanctuary Hills.
Yeah, Sanctuary Hills and the Red Rocket. There's the first one you do for the Minutemen, which is kind of like west of there, and it's in the north.
Mm-hmm.
And that's literally just a field and a busted house. So that's all. They're all dead. And then there's one like slightly south with that robot who, like Mr. Handy, flies around going, dude, wow.
Yeah.
He's amazing, but like everybody there is dead as well, aside from that robot.
Yeah.
I went down there and I just found him like floating around full of corpses. Mm-hmm. Just like, dude, wow, I've seen some shit, man.
Man. I'm having so much fun playing it as well, but it plays really nicely, which is what I'm really enjoying about it.
It does. I mean, I've kind of gone away from... You were saying like you've taken melee weapons. I've gone away from my fists now because I found a Gauss rifle.
Heard that. I've seen Andreas use it when he was on stream.
Oh, man. The Gauss rifle is so good.
Mm-hmm.
It's.
I believe it. What ammo does it use?
Specialized ammo, 22mm electron packs.
I've found so many of those, but I have not found the weapon, so I'm just like,
again,
I thought
Railroad.
I wasn't going to sell them.
Railroad has them.
I'll just keep with the Railroad, I think.
Yeah, I mean, I found
the Railroad as well.
Yeah, I nicked a Gauss rifle out of the Brotherhood stash on the Prydwen. So that was fun. Wait, have you... No. You don't know what the Prydwen is, do you?
No.
Never mind. Forget I said anything.
Okay.
You haven't seen any of the Brotherhood yet. There's more to come. Just do like another two missions and you'll be okay. But anyway.
I'm sure.
Yeah, it opens out very soon and then you can go gallivanting off again. But
I've put so many hours into it. I'm just like, oh, maybe I should do the main quests and then maybe I'll get more things to do. But I've still got a list of quests.
Yeah, once you get the Institute, it opens a lot of stuff out because there's so many more quests you can do. It's weird with Institute though, because when you go, like, initially you kind of convince them that you're friendly.
Uh-huh.
And then until you betray them, all synths are then friendly. So like I went into the Glowing Sea at one point and there's this like one sort of vault sort of area. It's like a government vault essentially.
Uh-huh.
And it's just full. I opened the door and I was like, right, okay, so you're going to be full of ghouls or full of raiders. Walked in, just full of friendly synths. And I was just there like, this is slightly anticlimactic. I've got nothing to fight.
Uh-huh.
And there was like two synth leaders, like six other synths just walking around. I'm like, yeah, this has been naturally a good fight, but they're all now friendly. So I can't do anything. So I nicked some power armor and then just like jetted out of there.
Nice. Yeah. Power armor's good. I like power armor. It makes me feel strong.
The jetpack attachment for power armor is very nice, I gotta say.
I need to get me some of that. Absolutely. So, final topic. It goes something like this. Dun, 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 dun. Star Wars, obviously.
Half an hour into the podcast and we're only getting around to our third topic. I like it.
I know, right? So that's good. Star Wars came out, I don't know, 2 weeks?
3 weeks. 3 weeks ago now, I think.
Jeez, yeah, 3 weeks ago. And I saw it a week after it came out. And it was awesome. I had a fantastic time seeing it. How about you?
I liked it.
Yep.
But I agree with what my dad said, because I saw this with my, like, my parents and my brother and his fiance and a lot of other people as well. There was not an original idea in that entire movie.
It was a spherical droid.
It was a good movie, but it felt like Star Wars 4.5. Like, it felt like a remake. It felt like a remake of Episode 4.
Both 4 and 5, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, look, the way they're taking it, hopefully they'll span it out a bit longer or a bit differently. Because if they keep on rehashing a lot of the old ideas, like, we've already said spoilers at the top of the podcast, so, like, for the fact they had Star Destroyer Mark... They had Star Destroyer Mark 2. Sorry, not Star Destroyer, Death Star Mark 2.
Called the Starkiller base, which is a throwback to Luke's original name.
Yeah, Starkiller, yeah.
I was like, oh dear.
It's, like, it was cool, but they had to just throw in just stuff after stuff after stuff. Then again, the one thing I'll say about the movie, which I didn't like, I did like it, the one thing I didn't like was the baddies in this one.
What about them?
The new Emperor, I don't reckon they should have shown. Point blank, I just don't think they should have shown him in this one. Because he was a hologram, but it's like, there's all the rumours going around that he might be Darth Plagueis, which was Palpatine's master, which I could kind of get behind because he's like scarred and disfigured, but we'll see where that goes. Mm-hmm. But I don't think they should have shown him. The guy who was the head of the Imperials, not Kylo Ren, the other dude, the Admiral, whatever the hell his name was, not threatening in the slightest.
No, like, not really. No.
Yeah, he's just kind of a throwaway. Like, he's as forgettable as the captain in Episode 5, who gets killed within half an hour of the movie starting. Suddenly, he gets promoted to admiral, and then Darth Vader fourth chokes him to death. And then Kylo Ren, I didn't like until the last half an hour.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he was just. But I read a little thing afterwards, which was that. What everyone was complaining about, like, Anakin was in, like, Episode 1, 2, and 3.
Yeah.
They distilled and they actively tried to make Kylo Ren like that, which is why I didn't like him. And then suddenly what happened at the end of... what happened at the end with him...
Yes.
Like, the last lightsaber fight where he was just, like... He was wounded, he just kept on, like, punching himself just to get the pain and the anger. Yeah. I was just like, shit. Okay.
Yeah. Like, there was so much to it. Like, that bit's... That, like, I don't know. It echoed for Episodes 4 and 5 so much that I was just like, oh, this is really cool. But I don't know how it'll hold up to, like, more viewings. Like, because I don't know. Okay, so this is going to be full-on spoiler right now. So
I think we've already passed that point.
Yeah, I know, right? So the bit where they're on the bridge, Kylo Ren and Han Solo, they're on the bridge.
Yeah.
Right. That there is both reminiscent of the end of Episode 5.
Yep.
And the end of Episode 4.
Yeah.
Where Obi-Wan's struck down in Episode 4. And then Rey suddenly knows what she needs to do.
Yep.
And also the...
Plummeting
to... Oh, you're my father. And then he falls into the center of the earth. And like, yeah. When Luke falls off at the end, because, okay, the roles have been reversed in that situation, but still, for one situation, it's the right way around, and for the other situation, it's been flipped, which is weird, but it's still, I don't know.
It kind of worked.
It works, yeah, but at the same time, it's, I don't know, it still feels a little heavy-handed. And they're like, yes, this is what's happening. You know what's going to happen.
The entire thing, aside from... Look, the entire thing felt heavy-handed. Yeah. Like, especially the last bit.
Yeah.
Like, that was the problem, I think. That the last big scene where they go down to Starkiller Base and blow it the fuck up...
Yep.
...felt so... Like, it was a great combo. It was a nice combination, but it was a combination of... When they're on the Death Star finding Princess Leia in Episode 4. The trench run in Episode 4. The Battle of Yavin, which is kind of, I suppose, like the expanded universe now, but, like, yeah, there's all that stuff in there with the fact that they were on another rebel base, which was in another fucking jungle, which also had another fucking set of temples. Where do they got that one from?
Mm-hmm.
Unless they said it wasn't Yavin. They actually said the name of the planet. I just assumed it was Yavin 4 again.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then Starkiller Base, like, blowing shit up, and then the fact they were going around and putting demo charges on stuff, like, at the end of episode 6 when they did Endor.
Yep.
And then the explosions, and, yeah, the bridge bit, and then, like, the only original bit of that scene was the lightsaber fight in the snow.
Yeah, basically. Because they gave the lightsaber some weight, and they actually looked...
Also the fact that you got two untrained people and somebody with essentially a claymore. Like,
yeah,
I basically. Don't know what... that actually makes sense now, because I saw that and I was like, ah, that's a bit weird.
Yeah.
But then he, when they have the saber struggling, he like gets him in the arm with the side blades, and I was like, oh, okay. Now that makes perfect sense now.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But yeah. There was so many other mirrors. Like, there was like the really subtle, the Rey gets tortured by Kylo Ren, the Leia was tortured by Darth Vader, and she didn't give anything up, but Leia didn't give anything up, but Rey also didn't get anything up, but that's where she really discovered what powers she had. And like,
I love that scene. That was one of my favorite scenes of the movie, though, when she discovered the powers.
Excellent.
Do you know who the stormtrooper
was? Yes, it was Daniel Craig.
I know.
It's so good. It's so funny that it's Daniel Craig. I was like, oh,
he got. Do you know the story behind that? Like, how he supposedly got that part?
I've definitely heard it because he talked about it.
But basically they were filming Spectre at the same time.
Yeah.
And it was literally the lot over.
Uh-huh.
And
yeah.
Basically they walked, a lot of the stormtroopers in the first scene
mm-hmm.
are extras or mm-hmm. other actors. I mean, they're extras in Star Wars, they're actors from Skyfall.
Skyfall.
Like, I'm pretty sure Daniel Craig's in that scene as well.
Not Skyfall.
Not Skyfall, Spectre. Sorry.
Spectre,
my bad. But I still haven't seen that yet either. It's gone out of cinemas now. I'm like,
it's
the
good.
First
It's entertaining.
Yeah. They just walked on... Well, you didn't quite just walk on set, but it was kind of like, oh shit, we need more stormtroopers. And then they was like, right, they're doing filming. Do you want to come over and be part of Star Wars?
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, if somebody comes up to you and just says, right, we just need you an extra. We just need a stormtrooper. Do you want to play on Star Wars? Do you want to be Star Wars? It's like...
Yes.
You're not going to say no to that, are you?
I'm going
to
say yes. It's like, oh man. Yeah, that was just like so cool. It's like, oh, that's awesome. But yeah, and like the end of episode 4, like how does the episode 4 ends with their victory? And
episode 4 just ends with explosions and then them congratulating each other on the ground. So this one was a lot more bittersweet.
There's the ceremony at the end.
Oh yeah, yeah.
The ceremony is how the film ends out. But this episode ends much reminiscent of Luke going to find Yoda as well. So it's. Now it's Rey going to find Luke, and like I said, it's very heavy-handed. Like, oh yes, these are all the things that have happened before, and it's very easy to draw parallels with what's happened in the what happened in the new film. But still, that doesn't make it a bad movie that we can predict what's going on. So, I don't know.
It doesn't make a bad movie in any way, shape, or form. But for the fact that it kind of gives me hope. The fact that
they're trying to get all of this out the way. All of
yeah.
it out of the way, and then they
they've drawn
stuff.
On all this stuff from episodes 4, 5, and 6
mm-hmm.
for this for obviously 7.
Mm-hmm.
So that means hopefully that 7 there's obviously going to be some stuff with like reminiscent of Yoda and Luke
yeah.
when Luke's training Rey. That's
yeah.
mm-hmm. unavoidable.
Yes,
there's probably also going to be some stuff reminiscent of Cloud City and like the way they're sort of like escaping at the end of episode 5 because the rebels are kind of on the back foot because.
Yeah.
Well, they are and they aren't, because basically both sides this time have had stupid, ridiculous losses.
Yes.
We'll see what happens
mm-hmm.
now, essentially. I'm looking forward to it, though, but I think somebody was saying to me that episode 8
mm-hmm.
is a summer release, as in like a year and a half away. It's
yes.
not going to be another winter release.
Yeah, that's my understanding as well. With
yeah, it's going to be
Rogue
Star Wars... It's
going to
be Star
year?
Wars... Yeah, it's not Rebels. Yeah, Rogue One is Christmas.
Yes.
I think. Which is the Bothan spy stuff pre-episode 4.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
And then, yeah, episode 8 will come out the summer after that. So, lots of Star Wars in the coming future.
Mm-hmm. I'm very much looking
thing.
Forward to it.
Mm-hmm.
It was a good film. As much as I'm ragging on it for playing the same things out again and again, it was very well acted.
Yeah, if anyone...
And if anyone doesn't, like, immediately just have... complete adoration for Daisy Ridley, I don't know what's wrong with them, because she is just remarkable.
I just love like her and this is John Boyega, isn't it?
Yeah,
just the pair of them just nailed it. Absolutely nailed it. It's some of the stuff as well, like coming out of John Boyega, and he's like, yeah, a lot of my mates thought I was an extra. And they were just like, what?
The first bit of the film as well, like when he lands, is it? Yeah, when he lands on the planet, and he keeps grabbing her hand. She's like, I don't need you to hold my hand. I was like, that's some of my favourite bits in the film. She's like, get off of me, you're slowing me down.
We're going for this ship. Bang. Okay, hunker junk it is then.
And then that reveal was awesome.
It was an awesome reveal. Like that was also... That is also one of my favourite scenes with the Millennium Falcon now. Like that chase scene across Jakku.
Yeah.
Was just insane. Because I think that's both of the... Because there was basically three space battles in that. There was the bit with Jakku with the two TIE fighters.
Yep.
There was low orbit in whatever name of the planet they went to when they got Han and Chewie, and there was the bar, which I don't even know where that was.
Oh, yeah.
When you find out that... what's his name? Still alive. I can't even remember his name now. That's really bad.
I don't know who you're talking about.
The rebel dude. He looks like he's going to be dead at the start, and then it's...
Poe Dameron.
Yeah, Poe. There we go, Poe. Yeah. And then, yeah, there's obviously the Death Star bit, or the Starkiller base bit.
Would you consider the whole thing, like... No, because there's days that pass before Finn gets to there. Because when Finn and Poe are escaping in the TIE fighter they've got... Is there a chase there...
I suppose it kind of is a chase, it's as much of a chase as many, but okay, it's four scenes
so
then.
Yeah.
But they were all so well done.
Yes.
Like they're some of the best space battles we've seen. Like as much as a lot of people say the prequels are crap, you got to admit that the bit at the start of episode 3, when it's Obi-Wan and Anakin with their Jedi TIE fighters essentially,
get into the
CIS ship. Is a really good space battle.
Yes.
And that's probably one of the favourite space battles, but these are all as good, if not better.
I'd argue that they're better. They're more intense as well.
Oh, much more intense, yeah.
Because the acting's better.
Yeah, the acting was really good this time, which was nice.
Which is, refreshing, which is wonderful for Star Wars. And, I think we should kind of wrap it up there because I could probably keep talking for ages. But
we could, but we're going on 45 minutes here.
I know, right?
Well, shall we?
We should probably stop.
Probably should.
Well, Dom, thank you very much for being my guest this week.
Always a pleasure, Topham. Thank you.
No problem. And with that, everyone, thank you for listening. Goodbye.
Bye.